Welcome to Rabbit Stew. It is Monday on Hyper RPG. We are super excited to be here to kick off the week. I'm Emily, your community manager.
I can introduce myself.
I know.
I'm Jackie Dash, or Claudia. You might not recognize me because my hair is short.
You did get a haircut.
I did.
It's pretty darn cute, I gotta say.
Yeah, I listened to the chat because it's technically a pompadour because it's the same on both sides.
Oh,
yeah. So technically, I can flip my hair like this if I wanted to.
Cool,
it doesn't
actually
like to do this.
No, but you can train it.
Yeah, and then Fang is gonna have top knot going on.
Ooh, I love it. So. Have you tried like pulling it back like a pompadour and gelling it?
I've done that before, like this.
Yeah.
Like I've done it. So, okay. So The Wicked and Divine is an amazing comic book, right?
Yeah.
And there's Lucifer, and it is like, up, yo. And I'm just like, oh baby, I am in love with like,
I look like
that's
that.
My cute
is that
hair.
What that is?
Yeah, I like supervillains, and she was super, super my type. I mean, not really, because if I liked girls, I'd be in love with that. So, Hey, Osborne.
Hello.
Did Emily get a new partner on?
Oh, on Trivia Hops.
Yeah.
On Trivia Hops or on Rabbit Stew? On Rabbit Stew.
It's me.
I've got my brand new partner. I feel like this is maybe a joke about having brand new hair.
Yeah, it is.
But
you're still working with your dad today, right? Thanks
no.
for resupplying.
No, Mitchell what? Got pulled away for he's going to like this, what is it called? It's like an E3 preview event for the judges of E3, so they're taking Necropolis to demo a bunch of judges to hopefully get nominated for a bunch of awards.
That's
which
fair.
Would be cool, and you know, have fun. You're not gonna get to sing with me, but
who's gonna be your partner then?
Liz Bolden. So she is Lizzie the Bold in chat and on Twitter, and she's been on Weekly Affirmations a couple of times.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
And also, she happens to be married to AJ from Death from Above, and I used to work with her at Hairbraids Games.
Oh, cool.
She's all kinds of cool. You guys are gonna love her, and yeah. So Claudia, tell me about your weekend.
Oh my
gosh.
I
didn't see you at all.
I know. Friday, I was kicked out of my own show. How rude. Have fun, Madrail. I know how to say your name. So, to answer your question and not read the chat, because I can do that.
Yeah.
I went to Oregon this weekend because I was kicked out of my own show. Whatever.
Uh-huh.
If not at all
uh-huh.
upset.
Uh-huh.
Whatever. Uh-huh. And I went to the farm where they didn't have internet. Oh my gosh.
That sounds lovely, actually.
I know. And then they have a big bathtub. Like I'm big enough to lay. So I had like a 5-hour bath and read book.
Great.
And what else?
What did you read?
Dealing with Dragons. It was a book that's different than
to me.
It's one
of my favorite books
of
all time.
It's so good.
Time.
It's so good.
Wait, have you moved on to the next part of
no,
the season?
No, I read half of it.
Okay.
And then I played a lot of Anime Army, which is called Fire Emblem.
Oh.
I finally decided who I'm going to marry.
What is Anime Army?
I finally decided who I'm going to marry.
Who are you going to marry?
Childhood friend who I've forgotten because amnesia.
Oh.
His name is Silius, and he's a knight. And see, I was gonna marry my butler, but it just our love story was not there. It wasn't.
But you know, with butlers, weird levels.
It was there. It was my first love, but he's not gonna be the one I marry and have a kid with. So that was a load off. Like as soon as I figured that out, I'm like, now all my life. So what's hard about this Fire Emblem is that people can be gay in it now.
Uh-huh.
Which makes it really hard because before I had 20 girls and 20 boys and I knew eventually there'd be a match.
Right.
But now all 20 girls can mate with the other 20 girls and it's so hard.
Mate? I don't know if that's quite the
no,
way that works.
No, but you do get so in Fire Emblem you either get a kid or you get super awesome punch attacks.
And what? Because those are exactly the
same
thing.
Sir Lucin. I'm going to completely stop talking about this. Otherwise, I'm going to...
I kind of want to go down the rabbit hole with you, but we can move on. It's
okay.
Fine.
Well, we'll then have to talk about my gay space. I watched so much gay anime yesterday. It was great.
Wait, gay space what?
So I'm reading this comic where they're gay space fighters, and there was not enough
gay
sex
space
in it.
Fighters, yeah, not they, space pirates.
No.
That's
no,
slightly
fighters,
disappointing. I have to.
Where
be
there's
honest.
Well, one's the pilot and one's the gun shooter.
Oh,
it's
gunner.
Great.
Officer.
Yeah. Because aww. Ships are complicated.
Of course,
they didn't have sex.
Ships are complicated.
And then
complicated.
I read one. I watched one that's beautifully done. I promise. I just watched it for the art. That's called this boy caught a merman, and it's about him going through grief And then finding out who he is. It was a great 30-minute short film. And
also catching a merman.
What?
And also catching a merman?
Yeah. The merman helped him get through his grief. And not through sex, because...
Not
through sex.
Interesting.
Okay.
What a plot twist.
Okay. I'm going to 100% be focused now and look at the chat because I was so distracted. Hello, Nate. Let's keep reading. Claudia, I got the Platinum Edition of Fire Emblem, so I have all three. Right now I'm playing through the Birthright because I'm slow.
Did you take a trip down the Oregon Trail?
No, I did not, but I did go outside for like 3 seconds.
I would really enjoy a trip to Oregon to go on the Oregon Trail, the Oregon part of the Oregon Trail with Jim Stewart Allen and Kirby.
That would be great.
That sounds like a really fun road trip.
That would be fun.
I feel like I would periscope the entire thing.
The issue is that we can't take vacations, right?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, Claudia changed her hair but didn't change her crazy. You know what's really great? Really great. This weekend, I got the batteries.
The batteries for my wand.
I got the batteries.
Oh my god.
Okay, so here's my thing. I want to turn them all on at once, just to show you. It sounds like hell. So I'm letting the chat know right now. If we play them, please take out your headphones and turn down your music. Hyper Rabbit Power Go! Eris, Liz, what do you want to say?
Less than 3 hashtag Renraku. Cause Gemisimo is mean and is making me do this donation.
Thanks, Gemisimo. Okay.
Gemisimo.
Okay, press them all. All of them. All the hearts.
I don't know if I want to do
you
this.
You have to.
I do.
Welcome to my show. Press all the hearts.
Here, hold two of these.
Oh my god, they're so loud.
Yep. I'm trying! Oh my
god. Make it stop.
No, I want to show off this one too.
Well, you got him at the same time.
Okay, you can't do it. There's no way to do it.
I mean,
there's no way.
He's got a lot of fingers, like most people in the world.
This is even better.
Oh my god.
If you wanna, da 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 da.
There's just one that's a little bit off.
And then I have this one, which I feel really bad about.
God, this one is really scary. So
there's a lot of things that's weird about this. One, it's on a string. And two,
yeah, why?
It's like a pig.
And but it's a really scary pig.
It's really scary.
It also kind of looks like a hairdryer.
Yeah, but it's and it also plays the worst song.
I'm gonna put that right there.
Ugh. It just like cuts straight through.
Yeah, are we doing
right
this?
To your chest, this? Like right the in the middle. Like, ow. Is it the little heart? Oh, yeah, I feel the heart button. Chills from it. It really.
Oh, it's Peppa Pig.
It is a Peppa Pig
knockoff.
Right. Oh god. Oh my god. Oh god. No.
I love this light off. Oh my god.
Okay. Oh, the chat is gonna, like, we're gonna never, like, the chat will eventually be over.
Please
okay.
Save me.
So, this is. Oh, that's so okay. Oh my God. There's so much that happened, and this was the main one, was that like Lauren let me put in all the batteries yesterday.
So
it's really her fault. She didn't take like yesterday. Well, yeah.
Lauren.
Yeah.
I'm gonna have some words with Lauren when she gets here tonight.
Hey everybody. Funny. Oh my gosh. No, I didn't break Emily. It's fine. It's fine.
I feel a little broken.
How many more silliness do I get before we have to start the news?
Like 30 more seconds.
Okay, 30 more seconds. What am I going to talk about?
Well, we have to talk about what's coming up on the day.
Oh, well, okay.
So
well,
we're not even that far yet.
Just to say things, I made Lauren play a dating sim, and she likes it.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I got my friends hooked.
I feel like I'm still like in a very weird, terrified state from like I can't quite get out of it.
We're going to push these away. We're going to push these away. Okay. See, they're even out of my hands.
I can't reach them.
Okay. And so which one was it?
Oh, it's called Amnesia.
Yeah, I think I
it's pretty
about
great.
That.
It's
you
pretty great. Yeah. Do you know what? Lauren is kind of house mom. Yeah. It wasn't the pigeon dating sim game. No,
oh,
no.
So did you hear anything about Gittlemania?
No, you have to tell me everything right now.
Okay, so my dad sold pictures of me, basically. Auctioned them off.
Oh, good.
Pictures of baby Emily.
Aww.
It's pretty great.
It's great. My mom, so a lot of what my weekend was explaining my mom, explaining to my grandma what I did right now.
Yeah.
They're like, how can we watch you? Oh, and I was like, well.
Well, grandma.
twitch.tv/hyper_RPG.
No underscore in there.
I was so close.
It's twitch.tv/hyper_RPG, but you all know that because you're there.
You guys are better than me. Those pics look nice.
Thanks, man. That's really nice of you. They were Emily at very interesting points of life. We didn't get into the very awkward 7 to 15 time
oh,
bracket.
The worst time bracket.
You 7 to 15 was rough.
Yeah.
But
No. Amnesia, not the Dark Descent. It was not Amnesia, the Dark Descent.
That would be a really interesting dating sim.
Though. Amnesia, the dating sim, is you wake up. Well, let me give you the plot synopsis. A spirit is going through dimensions and it lands in your brain and it pushes your memories out.
Oh, that's not very kind.
Yeah, so you are in this weird parallel dimension space where you don't know your memories, and so you have a choice between four different dimensions where there's four different boys.
Of course.
And one of the boys that I chose, because I love jerks, he has this problem where when he takes off his sunglasses, girls fall in love with him. So he was an hour
serious?
And a half. Yeah, he was an hour and a half late to my date. Because what? women were stopping him. Yeah, it's the Amnesia's the one with the hearts, diamonds, clubs, and spades. He couldn't help that he was an hour and a half late. Women were flirting with him so hard that he couldn't get there on time. Oh, and his number was the only number in my phone. So totally safe. Totally safe.
That doesn't sound like a good
relationship. Great relationship.
Yeah, like Osborne is saying that the underscore is just on Twitter for, HyperRPG.
Yeah.
And yeah, we've been trying to get the... not the patent, but like
the rights
to that name for
hyper
as long as we've existed.
RPG?
No, just hyper RPG.
Did you get it yet?
No.
Wait, you?
Because Twitter hates us and doesn't want us to have the things we want. Anyway,
so let's actually do our show.
Let's talk about today. Let's talk about today because today is going to be a good day. Today is going to be a ridiculous day. So Zach was supposed to be back today, and he kind of is.
He kind of is.
He came here for Full Tilt earlier, and he was painting Exo Manowar versus the Eternal Warrior from Valiant Comics.
Oh, that one thing.
Speaking of Valiant Comics,
so much good
stuff. Tomorrow we've got a special event from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. We are going to be live streaming the Valiant Summit straight from New York. So Zach is flying out to New York this afternoon, and he is going to stream the whole thing. And it's really exciting.
Awesome.
There are lots of really exciting events coming or upcoming things coming from Valiant. And one of them is our Valiant RPG. So if you don't have any idea what Valiant is or like if you just need a little bit of a primer, this is going to be a really good time to get caught up. So you should definitely tune in from 11 to 1 and then it'll roll right into Rabbit Stew. But I will not be here for that.
What?
Yeah. I don't know.
Oh, sorry. What?
What?
Okay, yeah. Who's going to be your partner?
I'm not sure yet.
I'm from Power Go.
Why?
Soul wants to contribute.
Really?
Nishi Woda Xiao Ya Xiao Ping Guo Ju Shang Tian Bai and Zui Mei Dian Duo Chen Tian Yu. Lai Dao Luokai Man Shan Po Zhang Sha Shi Wang Ju Wei Shou Huo Kong Bu Yao Deni Dao. Ye Ni De Yi Qi Yi Do Shi Huan Yu Ni De Mei Tian Do Shen Xian.
No, 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 no. I've put up with this for so long.
How long exactly?
Since you started here and brought that song to us.
When you say put up, do you mean in love with?
Did you fall in love with this song? Was some affection before, like ironic affection.
Nope.
Now it's fear.
No, you just wake up in the middle of the night. Dun dun dun. All right.
That sounds terrible.
Yeah. So there's a lot of Valiant stuff that's really cool.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
Yeah, it'll be great.
And Zach, wait.
Not yet. We think that's gonna happen.
I'm not gonna say anything. That was supposed to be a secret. It's fine.
Yeah. Anyway, it'll get you caught up for the Valiant RPG that we're gonna be doing. Yeah. So let's actually talk about what's happening today.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Because that's tomorrow.
Yeah.
So, today during Rabbit Stew, we actually have a guest, which is really awesome. I've known them for actually my entire life. They're pretty great people. They are the people behind Green Ronin Publishing, Nicole Lindrus and Chris Premis. They have a Kickstarter for the Book of the Righteous, which is a source book for 5th edition. And they will be here to talk about that.
Fifth edition. Of D&D. Dungeons & Dragons. Just
yeah.
to be clear.
And then on WTF is this, we have... This is going to be ridiculous.
Fine. Just read it out loud.
So the game is Goat Simulator.
Okay.
The hosts are Kirby and Goobers.
Goobers.
So how moist is that goat going to get?
It's going to get pretty moist. Here's my thing. Pretty moist. I'm so happy that Kirby is hanging out with new people, but I want to play Goat Simulator.
I just noticed this, and it's awesome.
Yeah, it's
show everybody your
it's
Beetlejuice.
My Beetlejuice pin. I'm
we just said Beetlejuice four times. So where is he?
Black and white. No, it's gonna be fine, guys, because they're in the yelling room. It's gonna be fine.
It's okay.
Kirby and Goobers is gonna be hilarious.
It's gonna be crazy, and we're probably gonna get
so
evicted.
Good. You're not gonna be evicted. If you didn't get evicted for this, you're gonna be fine.
It's true.
I'm pointing to the wands in case the camera can't see. All right, what is after Kirby and Goobers?
Okay, well, we're gonna team up again. Well, actually, we're not teaming up. We're going head to head. We're going head to head. So, musical trivia hops.
Yeah.
We've been teasing this for a while.
I'm so pumped.
But now we're excited. So, It's happening.
It's happening.
Team Emily and Liz. Team Claudia and Lauren.
Yep, because Lauren couldn't find a better one.
And then Team Alex Neat and Green-Eyed Trombonist, because Becca got a job, so she's not going to be joining us. But it's still going to be great. We're still going to troll the fuck out of Zach. And I feel like Lauren is probably going to kick my ass.
Lauren is going to carry me.
Okay, here's the thing. I was really depending on my father to carry me through this challenge.
Good. Team carry. Team backpack. Yes. Team backpack. Because here's the thing. I like musicals, and I can sing the musical parts.
Me too, except for the part where I'm sick, so...
We high five?
Sorry. Well, there's hand sanitizer out there. Just don't put your hands in your mouth.
I can't stop that. I love hands in my mouth.
Well, it's like this weird combination of allergies and a cold, but neither of them are completely there. Yeah,
Zen
Team Rabbit's probably gonna win.
No, it's not. I've won before. It's gonna happen again. You can't stop this. I wore my good outfit. It's really because I woke up early and didn't know what to do. So I was like, I better actually just care
just
about
get
my.
Cute.
Yeah, I'll care about my appearance today.
I really like your skirt.
Thanks. My little sister. Okay. Thanks for resubscribing, Jakool.
So if you still have questions for Trivia Hops tonight, please go ahead and
thanks for resubscribing.
Stump us. Get a Steam key. Also, I would like to remind everybody in chat that is not a subscriber yet, that if we get 5 subscribers by the end of the episode, we will give away a Steam key in chat.
I feel like Zach made the number 5, so I'd be like, this many.
Haha, my whole hand.
My whole hand. This many. Math major. Thanks for resubscribing. SMA S315.
Also, last thing is before we get to the news.
This is important for me.
Yeah, please announce this.
So, guys, in case you forgot, the MFEC corporate shirt corporate sins limited run shirts is going to end today.
It's got an hour, or it's got a
day and 6 hours.
A day and 6 hours.
I think we're going to be able to talk about it tomorrow as well.
Yeah, but you know, it's a day. Let's just throw it out there in case you need some time to think about it. Yeah.
It's so super excited. I'm going to have one. I'm super pumped. And we recommend not getting one of the colors. Can we look at the colors really quick?
Sure.
There's one that we...
I
think it's red. If you are colorblind, do not get the red shirt.
Oh.
That was it.
That would be difficult. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, if they're colorblind, they probably are looking at this going, I probably shouldn't get the shirt.
Well, we're helping them out.
We are.
We're helping them out.
Just in case you're listening and not...
Harebrained AJ.
That's AJ from...
Oh.
Death
from Oh, Bob. Hey.
That's... Yeah.
That makes sense.
I know that Liz is a super musical lady.
Good.
She texted me yesterday and was like, I've been singing this song from Cabaret in preparation. Yeah. I'm going to lean on her.
Sizen, does that answer your question?
So yeah, there's lots of colors.
Yeah. So
I'm probably gonna get gray.
Yeah, I got gray, I think. Gray is
cool. One day we can match.
But we won't.
Oh, but we won't. No.
Is there any other cool things that are gonna happen other than this awesome Valiant scream tomorrow? Kirby and Goobers, and then hey, who's gonna be the two hosts?
The hosts tonight on Trivia Hops are Kirby and dear old Sally.
I understand. Sally is really great.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, I could be a host one day.
You want to host?
I mean, I'm hosting this, but yeah.
Really? I feel like that would just be a mess.
It's fine. I'm Zach. I literally Zacked it up all over the place, everywhere.
You're not Zach.
I'm
Zach.
You
probably don't want to be.
I can't. Look at me. I don't sleep enough. I like being happy. Ah, dum-dums. Ah.
Wow.
That's Zach.
Oh my god.
He doesn't make that noise on the outside, but he makes it on the inside.
No, he just goes, shit.
You're right, Cryomancer. I want all the jobs. I only work like 4 hours a day. I need more things to do. Okay.
Do we need to give you more packages?
I need more to send more packages, which reminds me, in 11 subscribers or 12, there's a giveaway.
It's still 12. But yeah, in 12 subscribers, we've got a big physical giveaway. You know what? I think it's time to do the news. Well, there's been enough of this.
Joke. We spent 24 minutes. Now that we have a clock, we know.
We have a clock now, so we know exactly what time it is. We know exactly what the date is. We know exactly what day it is.
And we know how much time we've wasted. It's 24
It's been 24 minutes of this.
Joe, please cue the news. Hi, I'm Antoinette.
And I'm Jane.
I'm glad you said your name because I forgot it.
And
it's time
for
the news.
Okay,
so here's the first thing. Please click that. Better.
You're not keeping the news up very well.
No, I am. It's the news. Breaking
on
bulletin.
On Monday, it's Science and Technology Day here on Hyper RPG. And as your host, Antoinette, is here to guide you through the first article.
The first article. So, 3D printed hair leads to fuzzy machines and sticky blocks.
That
so,
sounds gross.
Scroll down, please. They've found a way to print 3D hairs without having a, mini thing. It's very cool. They grow and they're tiny polymer strands and they can make them longer and shorter, and it's very cool. This just reminds me of Shadowrun because there is we can watch the beginning of the video. It gets really slow.
Is it soft though, like hair?
Yeah. Cilia with 3 L's. Look at that. In Shadowrun, you can have glowing hair, and that's what just made me think about
that's
this.
Cool.
Is that you can just have Why does this make people uncomfortable? This could be a new way to make wigs.
That would be cool. It's not really hair-like, though, because it's so thick.
But look at this. But you can make it thinner. Like, it's saying you can make it as thick or thin as you'd like.
I guess I'm wanting to see it fully printed out. Like,
paintbrushes that have a customizable stroke.
That's pretty cool, actually.
Which I don't see it ever. What else can I do? Velcro. Velcro's cool. Look at that.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Huh.
Can't, it's just really cool.
Whoa, what?
Hair becomes an actuator to move objects because of the hair follicles. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Look at this. You hating on it?
No.
Look at, hair can also sort objects in a different way by vibrating. What? What?
But why is it hair?
Because they say hair because it's a lot of really thin things. This could be huge for violinists.
I kind of feel like the hair thing is just sort of...
All
it calling
is,
it something to get
people, yeah,
like eyes on it for being called hair.
That's fair.
Which, yeah, that's fine, I suppose.
Yeah, this isn't hair. A windmill that indicates incoming calls when your phone is in vibration mode, like that's not hair.
Yeah, but, call them strands. That's what Joe says. Yeah, I agree. Strands are better.
Yeah, we're getting really cool in the way that we can print very really thin things, micro strands,
mm-hmm.
Bristles.
Yeah, bristles works better for me.
All right.
We get the pictures.
Yes, we get the pictures. Very thin things are being... Oh, okay. It's more like cilia of bacteria. Thank
well, yeah,
you,
that's
Lugron.
Why they're called cilia. But, yeah, interesting. I totally think that that's a really viable option for, you know, violins and, like, instruments and stuff. Because, I mean, I don't actually know anything about how they get hair from animals for those things. But, in general, it seems like a...
Or, as Corporan Flyer says, everyone can have a beard.
I've never had a beard.
I wonder if I could, if I had that, I could, like, put things in the beard, because I'd make it really thick.
That would be cool, actually.
And I'd be like, pencils,
so, truthfully,
spoons.
The idea of having a beard kind of freaks me out. Like, having hair on
yeah,
your
I don't
face
want
like
hair
that
there.
Kind of makes me uncomfortable.
Next one.
But that said, people no. with books, or books with... Do you have something to say?
There's nothing freaky or uncomfortable about having a beard. I just want y'all to know that.
Goodbye.
I feel like having a beard would be... Really
this is my show. Can't believe that just happened. Okay, let's look at this. Darwin Cook,
yeah.
Who is a comic book great, as this article says, who does amazing art for comic books, is now deceased as of this weekend.
Pretty sad. He was really young. He was only 53.
Yeah.
And, yeah, his art is gorgeous.
His art is his own, like, thing. So if you scroll down, there's a lot of different art that he's done. And I've seen these arts, and I did not know he did them. And now I see that, like, everything is connecting. And it's tragic. It happens.
Yeah.
But he will be missed in the comic book world. Because his art style is so much comic book
so
art style.
Too.
It's so, it fits comic books so well, though.
Yeah.
Because of the highlighting and these arts. Yes, let's adapt. I kind of agree with you. It's just.
Have you read The New Frontier?
No, I've seen it so many times. I just haven't read it.
I have it. I can let you borrow
I would
it.
Love to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sad.
I think I'm going to that point where, like, the people who I used to, the celebrities that I actually know are starting to die.
Mm-hmm.
And it's that, like, oh, yeah, people are immortals.
Yeah.
All right, let's watch
wow,
these shorts.
Heavy. New oh, Overwatch short. New,
okay,
new Overwatch
we brought it
short.
Down, and now we're bringing it back up. We please turn on the sound.
I got you.
Okay, so we're watching the Overwatch. I don't know why I'm so bossy. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
So we're going to find more... background
I think
about
in general
Overwatch
it's okay to
characters.
Assume that I know how to do my job though
that's fair I just like the backseat dream
I know it's okay just teasing you
Nate's throwing shade
thanks Nate I've never heard that from you before
throwing shade
my family tells of an ancient legend about two great dragon brothers, the Dragon of the North
Thank
Wind
you for follow.
And the Dragon of the South Wind. Together, they upheld balance and harmony in the heavens.
Overwatch.
But the two brothers argued over who could better rule their land. Their quarrel turned to rage, and their violent struggle darkened the skies. Until the Dragon of the South Wind struck down his brother, who fell to Earth, shattering the land.
Oh, look at that, Pompadour. Oh, I love it.
You could be that guy.
I am that guy.
The Dragon of the South Wind had triumphed. But as time passed and he realized his solitude, the sweetness of victory turned to ash.
I agree with you, Nagihama. He does need a wolf blade. Maybe that's what he's getting.
For years, the bereft dragon's grief threw the world into discord. And he knew only bitterness and sorrow. One day, a stranger called up to the dragon and asked, "Oh, Dragon Lord, why are you so distraught?" The dragon told him, "Seeking power, I killed my brother. But without him, I am lost." The stranger replied, "You have inflicted wounds upon yourself. But now, you must heal. Walk the earth on 2 feet as I do. Find value in humility. Then you will find peace."
"You are not the first assassin sent to kill me, and you will not be the last."
"You are bold to come to Shimada Castle, the den of your enemies."
"This was once my home. Did your masters not tell you who I was?"
"I know who you are,
Hanzo.
I know you come here every year on the same day. You risk so much to honor someone you murdered.
You know nothing of what happened."
"What?"
"I know you tell yourself that your brother disobeyed the clan, and that you have to kill him to maintain order, that it was your duty."
"It was my duty, and my verdict. That does not mean I do not honor him."
That's not how arrows work.
"You think you honor your brother Genji with incense and offerings? Honor resides in one's actions."
"You dare to lecture me about honor? You are not worthy to say his name!"
Ooh. Stab him with the arrow. Oh, there.
"You go, Wagateki Okuro!"
Oh, that was cool.
Oh, that's why
you need to kill you. Only a Shamada can control the dragons. Who are you? Do it then. Kill me.
He can't.
No. I will not grant you the death you wish for. You still have a purpose in this life. Brother. No. Oh. My brother is dead.
That doesn't... Okay.
The dragon knelt upon the ground. For the first time, he was able to clearly see the world around him, and he became human. The stranger revealed himself as his fallen brother. Reunited, the two set out to rebuild what they had once destroyed.
What have you become?
I have accepted what I am, and I have forgiven you. Now you must forgive yourself. The world is changing once again, Hanzo. And it's time to pick a side.
Real life is not like the stories our father told us. You were a fool for believing it so.
Perhaps I am a fool to think there is still hope for you. But I do. Think on that, brother.
Who's the good guy? Neither of them.
Ambiguous.
I think you're right. I think Hanzo is the bad guy. Here's my thing about everyone who said that Overwatch should be a movie or a TV show. All they've done is shown us the backstories of every character, which is dope. But here's the thing. I don't know if we can make a story that intertwines all these characters. They're no Avengers.
It's possible. Okay, I have a couple of things to say. Chat, I was reading you during this. Corbin Flagger, I would look great with a beard. I have a picture of me with a glitter beard that I will post on Twitter later. It looks fantastic. Second, Nate, back at ya. And third, there are a couple things about the short that I really like. So, First of all, I really like that even though I'm someone who doesn't necessarily want to play Overwatch because it's not my style of game, I'm still into the backstories of everybody. Mm-hmm. I really like the characters. I really like all the stuff that's going on around it. So if they ever bring out some like movie or something like that, I'm totally in. All these different things about it that I would be into. So also,
there should be a story mode.
Story mode would be awesome.
I would love to play story mode.
I would even love, you know, they're bringing out all these other games. Like there's, what is that called? The Heroes of the Storm? That's what it is. Yeah, Heroes of the Storm. They've got that. It's a completely different game.
Mm-hmm.
So that's cool. They've got like all these different styles that they're trying to approach all these different people with for this franchise, which I think is smart. And there's got to be something there for everybody, you know?
Yeah.
And like it just so happens that the shorts are good for me and like the games not so much. But I really like the world that they're building.
Yeah, and they're doing a really good job building that. I personally thought that there was only the videos to watch, but Nate is letting me know that there is world building in other ways.
Yeah. Also, I just love, like, there are these little moments in this short that are, it just gives so much depth to it. Like, the smallest things, like, I noticed that when he put down the incense holder, it wasn't completely centered with the floor. And in some things, they would center it with the floor, and it would be like this it was just like a little bit more human, a little bit more like,
they did a really good, I wonder,
it's like those little things that people do in things like this that really help solidify like this is a reality, you know?
Yeah they have a good director. Denolio says they have a free series of comics on their website, so I might have to check that out.
Yeah.
And honestly, it might be the case where we get everything we want and then we don't like it. But I agree. I would like to have a single player mode.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Even if it's just like three levels of each character where you're like, I can learn how to play this character now.
That would be
and
really
also
good.
I feel satisfied.
That sounds very time consuming.
Yeah.
Sounds like so many resources
I
for them.
Like
but
that.
But that
I would
sounds
pay,
great.
I would pay like $2 or $3 for each DLC pack of
really only that much?
For each one.
Yeah.
So think
but
about
that's
how
like
many
a dollar
are.
A level.
Yeah, Joe wants to remind us that that video that we watched is a level in the game.
Got it. That's
which
smart, yeah.
was super cool. Somebody else called that out in the chat. I don't
That's
have a
so
name.
Smart of them. Like, I just think that what Blizzard is doing with their marketing for this
it's great.
Is
it's
so
great.
Good. They're
they
positioning
also,
themselves so well.
And they pulled in Penny Arcade for East, I think.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they did like the battle for the watch. I don't remember what it was called. But it's really cool.
Look at some cool
If costumes. They finish all these short releases with the announcement of a story mode option, I mean, I'm already going to buy the game, let's be honest.
Yeah.
But I want more of it.
Let's take a look at some cosplay.
Cosplay.
Oh, wait, this is a dude.
This is the cosplay.
Is it though?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Actually?
Yes.
I believe you, but...
Scroll down.
There's more?
There's
oh,
more.
There's more. Huh.
He did a very good job at The Witcher, and what I like is he actually looks the age. That the Witcher
yeah,
is supposed to be.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, this one's a little bit more believable for me, but all of them are, like, photoshopped to the nth degree, so it looks
good,
like...
Good cosplay's always photoshopped.
Like, I know, but it doesn't even look like... Like, is that a wig or is that...
That's a wig.
Photoshopped hair. That's sometimes the thing that I have a hard time with cosplay imagery, is that I want to see the work that went into it, and sometimes if you overly Photoshop it, it doesn't look... Like, no. I it's fine to have some, because then it's... Like, oh, it's really cool. Like, I'm putting myself into the thing, and it totally works. But, yeah, sometimes it's very confusing for me to look
yeah,
at these and believe that it's cosplay.
The chat's kind of on your side, whether you think there's too much Photoshop. But even if that close-up, he looks, if
yeah,
he looks
I mean,
like
in,
the character.
In the close-ups,
yeah.
It's really cool.
It's really great makeup.
Yeah.
Really, like, that
the scar is no joke.
Baller.
I like it. This is really cool.
This isn't that whole realm of do you like silver foxes? And my answer is always no.
What? Oh.
Like, I can't do it, The Witcher. Nope. But, like, then there was Hanzo, where I was like, you're almost there. You're gray and you're just too old. Just too
understand,
old.
I understand.
I don't think that's his real skin there in the faraway picture. It might not be.
Yeah, it didn't look like it. It was very strange. Oh, we tried to look at this.
Colored contacts is what I'm thinking of.
On Gittlemania, but it was a downer, and I
so we're
I skipped
gonna watch it.
It
now.
So we're gonna take a look at it now because it's really cool.
It's cool.
It's sad, but it's cool, and that's okay.
So the idea of this game, which is got a trailer for it, it's called Fragments of Him. It's about it's a trailer for one of those story games
mm-hmm.
about a gentleman who is queer. I think it was a male.
Yeah.
Who died really early.
And it's all about sort of the fallout of his family and his boyfriend, I think, around him.
Another
making up a lifetime.
It felt like we were the only people in the world.
How are we supposed to go on? People talk about getting closure, but his story was only half written.
I've let myself lose track of what I want after everything we've been through.
Handle it.
I can't too handle
sad.
It. Like, I distinctly remember crying for hours because I watched the news on the day of 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I dislike seeing people that are sad in the point where I'd rather watch a horror movie than feel sad things. Which is so funny in telling about our generation.
It is.
Where
yeah.
people will stay away from this because they'd rather feel scared than sad.
I am really into this idea, actually. I'm really looking forward to playing this game because I really appreciate interactive narratives, and I'm very interested in the way that they're going to use this game to explore grief and like how people process that sort of thing.
Yeah, the processing of grief will be an interesting view. And for me, like, I'm seeing this because the article says powerful new queer video game deals with loss, or love, loss, and healing. And in the back of my head, like, a negative voice is like, would this game get any press
if it wasn't queer?
I think yes. I think it would too. I think the reason why they're saying queer is because there's not a lot of games that include
queer. Right, and so it's nice to have something that is involving of that. Yeah, I'm actually really looking forward to this. I don't mind sad things. So.
The article doesn't... it will debut on the Xbox One and PS4 later this year. The game offers a look into the memories of snapshots of four people, the victim, Will, his boyfriend, and his ex-girlfriend, and his grandmother. So, no PC.
In the end, the game is about the value of opening your heart to others. I think that's nice.
Lock my heart in and close it shut.
On a more upbeat note, there's...
World of Warcraft cookbook. You have to...
It's pretty decent.
Here's the thing. You need to have canned haggis for one of the recipes.
Why canned, though?
I don't... Where do you find regular haggis?
You make it.
Well, then canned haggis is the step shorter than that.
I actually really like haggis.
I've never had it.
It was pretty good, actually. I went into it going like, I don't know about this. And then by the end, I was like, that was delicious. Give me another one.
Yeah. Yeah. Good. No, but some of these look really interesting. Like, I would eat that.
Oh, I would definitely eat this. Is it just broccoli?
Oh, and never kale? Mind. It looks like kale. But look at the...
Oh, that's cute.
Yeah, that is super nummy looking. You know what I need right now? A donut. Oh. Heavenly sigh for donuts. That's how you get into Hyper RPG's heart is donuts.
So listen, after this, we should go get some donuts.
Yep, let's do it.
Sounds really good.
And there's a cherry grog recipe and Earthglen ambrosia.
Isn't ambrosia really just... It's like a fruit salad, though.
Yeah, but no, that's a drink.
But this is a drink.
Ambrosia is a candy that I know.
Listeners are always looking for new ways to get drunk in character. Can you imagine if you could just carry this around on your belt, like, as you're cosplaying?
Yeah.
That sounds pretty great. Dragon breath chili.
Sweet potato bread looks really good. It looks good. This is by the person...
It's an official cookbook.
Mm-hmm. This is by the guy who... Or woman, I don't know. Who did the Game of Thrones cookbook.
Oh, and the Game of Thrones cookbook is pretty good, actually.
Yeah, so be excited.
Everybody, talk to me on Twitter about Game of Thrones last night because I'm not allowed to talk about it here.
Don't talk to me. I just said
I'm not allowed to.
You know what's hilarious? I watch it with my dad.
I watched it with my parents.
Yeah, I watch it with my dad. And most people are like, you watch it with your dad. Isn't that weird when they have sex? I'm like, no, because
I'm an adult and I can get over it.
What was I going to say?
My little sister goes like this now.
But we're going to stream it. So we're going to watch like 4 in a row. Yeah.
Nice.
I'm with you, Vercat, Joel. I haven't watched any. Oh my gosh. No. Yeast or...
Jolene.
Wait, cake or yeast, Claudia? I don't know what you mean, Demoon Rules. I'm going to eat everything is the answer you wanted.
Oh, that sounds delicious. All right, but listen, Game of Thrones this season is so good. We are at the halfway point, I think. And I just want to say... It's really good. Now that they're away from the books, they can just go like, boom, 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 plot, plot, plot. Here's all this cool stuff that you've been waiting for 5 seasons to happen, and now it's happening. That's good. Keep doing that, please. So good. Find me on Twitter, Emily Gittleman, and let's talk about Game of Thrones because...
Yeah.
Because I need to.
But not me.
But not right now.
Not me. No, I'm not going to stream me watching Game of Thrones with my dad. Definitely not.
Nobody wanted to shut up last night. Everyone was like talking over the show.
I just wanted
to kill everyone.
Oh, I like the fluffy kind of... I like fluffy kinds of donuts.
I love cake donuts.
I don't. They're too dense. If I wanted a cake, I'd eat a cake.
But I don't really like cake that much. Cake donuts are actually denser than cake. It's like a pound cake. I love it.
I can't find the article I wanted to read about.
Which one?
There you go.
That's interesting.
So, people in the UK might know about this. There was a group of YouTube pranksters.
Hold on, Joe. What? Brioche donuts?
What's brioche?
Brioche is a delicious kind of bread. And, oh my God. Oh my God. Joe, where Where do I get those?
Why are we talking about beards again?
We're talking about beards. We're talking about donuts.
Not getting beards. And yes, 12 subs away until BattleTech physical giveaway.
12.
Oh, can we add a donut place to our treat stream?
That might be a possibility. I will look
Figure
into
it out.
That. I will look into
do
that.
Do it, because I would like some donuts in my mouth.
Pot after this.
So
okay.
The video is kind of shows you why this All is right. happening. So this is...
Let's take a look.
The first thing that the YouTube pranksters decided to make
sound?
a fake heist in a museum.
Oh,
so
God.
So this is the thing that happened when they made a fake heist in the museum.
That's dangerous.
Yeah. So the main issue is in England.
Look at this jerk.
Well, he's trying to understand
look
what's happening. He's recording it because they're fake.
Why would someone heist
because
in the middle of the day?
As Joe says, it's just a prank, bro.
But it's dumb.
So these pranksters have done 3 pranks, one with a fake bomb threat, one with like this, and there were some other ones that I can't remember, so we'll scroll down. Did Emily say she wants pizza? Yes. Yes. Give me pizza.
P-I-Z-Z-A.
Okay.
All right. Anyway, so... So, they're from Troll Station? Is that really
yeah,
their YouTube channel? Yeah,
Troll Station's
name?
Name, their YouTube
terrible.
Channel. So they've had fake robberies and kidnappings. And at this point, they've given 8 weeks in jail for the fake kidnappings. And each of them have gotten different amounts for the other YouTubes that they've done. Yeah, 12. So here we go. Troll Station member Don Van Lee was sentenced to 12 weeks of imprisonment in March for his involvement in the fake robbery and also 24 weeks for a separate bomb hoax.
Oh, didn't we read about that a couple weeks ago?
Yep.
Wow, these people are idiots.
Our aim was never to get away with breaking the law, a member of the group known as The Light told BBC at the time. Said the group hoped to continue but would reevaluate their approach. Here's the thing. Like, there's a difference between a felony and a hoax. And there's a couple other people.
Wait, but how did they do it?
Like, fake
Did they actually... pick it up off of the wall or
probably not. I'm not gonna watch the video, but I bet they like in their backpacks had like
what idiots dude. Oh my God, that's so dumb. Like, why would you do that? It's not funny. It's
a prank.
Well,
guys.
Pranks should be funny.
Yeah.
This
my favorite
is just stupid.
My favorite is pranks where they like literally it's just making the person playing is like a little bit foolish, but like it's not bad.
Yeah.
And they feel safe. That's
right.
The thing.
Also, did you see this? Sorry, I just want to talk about it for a second. So this woman was presenting on KTLA, which is the morning news in LA.
Okay.
And she came out in this little black dress.
Looks cute.
It is cute. And like they got a ton of what? Oh, it really was a joke? Oh, then never mind. Apparently, so they made a whole thing about how they were joking that she needed to put on a sweater because they were getting email complaints.
No, because there was a chill in the air.
No, there wasn't.
Oh, it wasn't because there was a chill.
Yeah, and anyway, I guess it was a joke.
That's what Joe says.
All right, well, then never mind. Never mind. We're moving on.
We're moving on.
Sounded like Billy on the Street there. Never mind. Moving on.
I have no idea what you're
talking
about.
Okay, fine.
Oh, we can scroll back all the way up. Oh, yeah, we were talking
about
this
about this. This is so strange because... So, scientists made see-through wood.
See-through wood. They made it.
They made it. Basically, what they did was they took this wood, they put it in, what was it? Sodium hydroxide and other chemicals?
Epoxies.
Yeah, so they put it in sodium hydroxide and other chemicals to take the color out, and then they poured epoxy over it to make the wood stronger. And then it's wood.
But it's see-through.
But it's see-through. But it's, like, wood in the middle.
But it's wait, scroll up for that one paragraph. One of the great properties of the treated wood is it retains the structure and natural channels from when it was a tree. And these microchannels can deliver light similar to how they move nutrients around as part of a plant. So the idea is it's technically transparent.
Right. So the idea is to let you, like, get some water. I mean, what?
Light.
Air. Light.
Yeah. Not air. Light. But,
fire.
Yeah. But the idea
power,
is they keep...
Heart. Captain
they've
Planet.
Not been able to make a lot of thick things. So 5x5-inch wood blocks are as large as they've been able to make it work.
Yeah.
So, like, this big. So, yeah, it's wood, sorta. It's wood, sorta.
Yeah. Oh yeah, so chat, you're talking about the sweater thing. Yeah, so basically what happened was they were asking her to put on a sweater because they were getting these emails. And so jokingly they were like, "Ha ha, put on a sweater. America can't handle shoulders."
I don't know. I need to know more. I can't make a judgment about whether it was the news team or guests or a joke, and I don't want to.
Well, and I watched not a live stream, but like a video on Twitter afterwards, and they were going through all the emails, like all the hosts were all going through laughing, and they were all individually streaming it. It was really weird.
Weird.
Anyway, so yeah, this is really interesting, and I think that it, I don't know, it's got some promise in the future, but it's.
I mean, here's the thing.
It's cool because I can imagine it being used in houses for like one wall, and like instead of it being a window that you open, it's just a wall that lets in some light, kind of like those bathroom tiles, you know? So that could be cool.
I think the idea is that this individually cannot bring up new sciences, but we can use this to continue to grow, which is important. And remembering in science is not everything is a success, but you're still learning from it.
Right.
Woo-hoo. I could be a news reporter. Look at that.
Let's see, which one you want to pick?
We can scroll back up and continue where we were at. Sorry. Project Spark is shutting down. I don't know what Project Spark is. This article does a terrible job of telling me exactly what's happening. But they're pretty much saying Microsoft's curious private Spark game and or creativity engine is all done, but they're going to take it off the market.
I wonder if it was kind of like... Lumberyard. I mean, maybe
what?
Not.
I don't know what Lumberyard... That doesn't help me.
Lumberyard was the thing that Amazon came out with that it has Twitch integration. Oh. So it helps you build games with Twitch integration.
Oh.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
So it's like, it's starting 5/13/16, Project Spark will no longer be available for download on the Xbox Marketplace or Windows Store. The online services will end at the end of this summer.
Yeah, but there's really not... a whole lot of information about it anywhere.
But even if you bought it, it looks like they're going to receive a credit to your system. Oh, it's Microsoft's Little Big Planet. Thank you, Neuromancer. And that's kind of sad. I wonder why they canceled the project.
I wonder if there was really a market for it.
Probably not. But it still doesn't make sense to cancel it.
Yeah, it does.
If you put so much money into it.
Yeah, but if you keep putting money into it, then you don't get money back.
But you'll never know. It could have been a success.
Big companies, yeah.
Everyone talking about Captain Planet as a like revamp or on Netflix, I'd be so down for that. So down.
Who would you cast as Captain Planet?
Doesn't matter.
Don Cheadle.
I don't know who that is.
I love Don Cheadle. He was what's that guy's name in Captain America? I saw Captain America over the weekend.
We did. We both saw it. Yeah. We're not gonna talk about
it. Different feelings. We're not gonna talk about
it. I really liked it. We're not gonna spoil it.
We're not gonna
really
spoil it.
But I had low expectations going in.
I also had low expectations. I really didn't have any going in at all, except for that Zach was really excited for it.
Zach's excited for lots of things.
But the thing is, I was actually slightly underwhelmed, and I feel like I'm actually in the minority.
Underwhelmed?
A little bit. Well, I feel like there was a lot of build-up for it. A lot of build-up. And I don't know. Like, the main conflict was a little bit forgotten at one point, I feel. And... also, okay, everybody knows that. That's been announced.
What?
Spider-Man is in this movie.
Yeah, he's the best character.
Yeah, he is the best character, but I really liked him. But I also kind of felt like the jokes that he was given made him dumber than he is.
It made him a child, because he's a child.
Right, but he was supposed to be a 16-year-old really smart kid.
Eh.
And he kind of made dumb jokes. But I'm not going to spoil that one.
We're not going to spoil it for you.
It's a good joke until you think about it a little more. What's happening in
chat? Sorry, I'm looking at Megaloblizmon is talking about, my friends are talking about nostalgic conversation. I was like, hey, do you remember where Linka's cousin does crack, falls off a building onto glass, and bleeds to death in front of them? I don't remember that episode. We're gonna not talk anymore about this movie because it's not movie day. It's science day.
It's okay.
David Spade as Captain Planet.
Oh my god.
Oh my god. That'd be the worst. Oh, that'd be the worst. Okay.
I hate that idea. Stop that.
So, Google plans to phase out Flash. And not the superhero Flash.
Really?
No, it's Adobe Flash, which I don't know what Adobe Flash is used for at this point.
It's for videos and stuff.
Well, then what are they going to use?
I don't know.
So, a plan outlined last week, Flash will be disabled by default in the fourth quarter of this year. There are a couple pages where it will not be in the top 10 domains like Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, Amazon, but it's only a temporary thing. Hmm. Wow, everyone is telling me use HTML5. I don't know what that is.
I'll follow your lead.
I will Google it when I go home. Wow.
If this was the 90s, I'd say Dean Cain for Captain Planet. I could buy that.
Who's
I could
Dean
buy
Cain?
That. Dean Cain, he played Superman.
Oh, yeah. I can see that.
You know, I feel like The Rock would actually be really good. No.
But somebody asked for more wand. And I listen.
You don't have to listen.
I do. Whenever the chat tells you to do something, I'm like, that seems like a good idea.
It doesn't.
Can I at least hold? It goes so well with my outfit.
I feel like I can just feel the fear bubbling up.
I'm just going to hold it. It'll be fine.
Oh, no. I'm glad you're happy.
It's not very hard to make me happy. I like to think that I'm like, woo! I get really happy really easy and really sad really easy.
So you're a roller coaster.
Yeah.
We're all riding the Claudia roller coaster here.
Claudia roller coaster, it only goes up and then it crashes. It crashes hard, guys. Okay. This is actually really cool. So, have you ever wondered what it's like to be an archaeologist?
Yes.
Under the water?
Yes.
Yeah, they show videos of this.
Ooh.
Yeah, so the main concept is in Florida, there was this big pit, and they found a hunting gathering place where they found a cut-up mastodon and tools and even dog bones.
That's cool.
Yeah, and it works because they know that they were hunting the mastodon because there are, like, knife marks in the bones, which is super cool because I'd be like, well, it's just dirty.
That is super cool.
Watch, scroll down. There's more about the video.
Okay.
The video is kind of boring, but it's cool. It's only
good
a minute.
Good setup. The video is kind of boring, guys. We're going to watch it anyway.
Watch it. It's cool because you've never seen a scuba diver archaeology.
So where are they?
Florida.
Okay.
But like, look, they've got this like, oh, I'm going to slowly dig to find it.
Going to be
boring,
very gentle
but
as an
cool. What's the subject for Trivia Hop today?
Musicals.
We're going to do as much as we can without getting kicked off.
Yeah.
But also like, oh, nice job,
Joe. Thank you for the music,
Joe. Look, there's like a laser underwater.
That's hella cool.
How do you make a laser underwater?
Okay, so truthfully, all I really want from the rest of my life, that's a little excessive, but what I really, really, really want is a VR game that allows me to be Indiana Jones. Why?
We've got a fever, and the only cure is more wand. Let's get some sweet wand hype. Hashtag Neonite, hashtag Juan Browns, hashtag David Spade.
Oh my god, there's another one.
I pulled this one and I didn't put it away.
Wait, is that Sailor Mercury?
No.
Oh, no, that's...
It doesn't... It makes a different song.
I like this one better. This is way better.
But what I also... This is the only one that has... A no noise option.
Oh, I'm okay with that.
Yeah, so.
I like no noise options.
These ones don't come with that option.
Yeah, Claudia, if you were an archaeologist, you'd probably ruin everything. What do you think? Yes, no? True fact?
Have you guys seen that GIF where they're like cleaning off the archaeology head and then somebody's like, I'm helping?
Oh god, no. That sounds terrible.
Oh.
Anyway, this is incredibly cool.
And remember, it's 14,550 years old.
That's really old. That's really old. That's
really old.
That sounds really cool.
Yeah,
though.
So they talk
Man,
a lot about
I
what's there.
I would really like to be the person finding those things.
Nope. I am so on finding new things, like how there's not enough wands in America right now. I should just start making a line of my own
You're
wands.
You're hurting me.
I could be like, Minker says no more wands.
You're hurting me.
I can make noise without that.
How about this one?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So, Boeing, which is a big thing in Seattle and Tacoma.
Sure is. Washington.
In 2 years, in 2018, they would like to send a crewed Starliner launch, which means they want to send things to space in 2 years.
Wow. Hey, thank Hello. You for the sub.
Friend Computer welcomes a new thumper for science.
Hyper Rabbit Power Go. I don't know if we're doing that anymore, but.
Yeah, Hyper Rabbit Power Go.
Woohoo. Ah. Thanks for subscribing. If we get 4 more subscribers by the end of the episode, we will give away a Steam key in chat.
I would just like to say that was the most professional response to we have a subscriber. It was, ah! ah! What to do.
I did not know that Boeing had a defense, space, and security division. Oh, and it's a lady.
Yeah,
that's cool.
Totally not supervillain stuff.
So they're working on their first unmanned flight in 2017, followed by a manned astronaut flight in 2018. Hmm, interesting.
That's pretty cool.
I think I've said this before, but I think that it's very interesting that space is being privatized because NASA has been like pretty cool with that. It allows them to focus on other things like getting to Mars. So, I'm
Yeah, everyone
intrigued.
Else can hang out in space, and they'll just keep trying to go to Mars.
Basically, like, they can handle, like, SpaceX and Boeing can handle the, like, shipments of stuff. But NASA can set their sights high.
To the moon.
To perhaps. The moon. They've been there. To Mars, maybe.
Yeah, I still want a moon colony, though. Like, I would like a moon colony.
Yeah, that sounds pretty cool, actually. But at the same time...
Oh, that's. I was wondering, like, why do we care about moon colonies? And in Final Fantasy XV, the chick is from the moon.
That's the only reason.
That's the only reason I'm thinking of right now.
All right. Okay. Cool.
That's what made me think about that. We need. I'm super into science, guys.
Oh, no. Every time you donate, my heart. Skips the beat.
Good. Good. And it
finds
too.
It's so jarring.
Pound sign hashtag hashtag more ruins.
You can hold a yellow.
I'll take this one.
The no noise one?
Yeah. I like no noise.
I wish my wall.
No, that's noise.
You gotta go up. This is what happens when I run my show. Okay, we have very limited time.
We do because we've got a guest coming on today.
Yeah.
Two
We're
guests,
super
actually,
profesh.
From
you
Green
can
Marine.
See we brought our A game right now.
You brought your A game. And I brought my, I don't know. Yeah, how long until you hit me in the face with
a wand?
I have
not hit anyone in the face with a wand.
Not yet.
Oh, read about. Scroll up, please. Please read about the penile transplant.
The first U.S. penile transplant. Transplant has taken place.
So, I want to go back to being who I was, says the 64-year-old retired.
I love his little thumbs up.
I got a new penis.
I'm happy for you, man.
So he lost his penis
to cancer.
To cancer,
that
which
terrible.
Sucks. Cancer sucks.
Nobody's
right?
disputing that.
But he got...
A 15-hour operation done on May 8th and May 9th.
Mm-hmm. Won't you read this?
They perfected things? Their technique for 3 full years. So he is recovering well with blood flow established to the donor organ and no signs of bleeding, rejection, or infection. That's great.
That's super important. Where'd they get it from?
I mean, someone had to die for them.
Oh, well, yes, but like, is this like every other organ?
I believe so. I mean, it probably had to be, it had to be someone who matched his blood type. It had to be someone who matched, like, a bunch of different factors, you know.
But this is important. If you scroll up, it talks about in 2012, when he lost his tuner, he couldn't be in a... He said he just did not want to be in a relationship with anyone.
Yeah.
Because he's like, I don't have a, like, how would it sound to going to a woman who you're very uncomfortable, you're still trying to form a relationship and be like, I don't have a penis. Like, and that's such, or I guess I had a penis amputation is nicer. But like, yeah, I have so many stupid inappropriate questions about this. But it's just, it's really great that he can feel like he can have a relationship again, which yeah. that's the great part about this. Jokes aside, that's really great.
Yeah, there are plenty of jokes to be made here, but at the same time, like, why bother? It's great that this guy is going to be able to experience things again.
Can we do both? Can we make jokes and say how great it is?
I mean, in good taste.
In good taste, chat. You heard
good
it.
Good taste. I will come down on you hard if you
good
don't.
Good taste.
In good taste.
I like how much I pick him up and I'm just like, ah! Oh, Hamza said maybe a person who was transitioning donated it.
Oh, that would be really interesting.
That would be really interesting.
I don't know if that's the way that works.
That'd be an interesting rom-com.
Oh my god.
Or a porn.
Oh my god.
Okay, we have 3 minutes left. Let's keep back. Cabin focus. Let's focus. Let's keep it tasteful. Oh, I see that the chat wanted to talk about whether penises and taste can't be in the same word. Sorry, guys. Sorry. Okay, so let's talk about this article.
Yeah, let's.
Emily, why don't you take it? Because I'm obviously cut off for right now.
For right now. So this is an interesting article about racism, Hearthstone, and Twitch. So basically, I think it was, last weekend, there was a Hearthstone competition that was streamed, and there were two people. One of them was a black guy, and one of them was a white guy.
Okay.
And basically, in the finals, there were people being total dicks.
Total
dicks. They were just spamming racist stuff in the chat. And I guess there were only 10 moderators. So
yeah, that's how much you need for a national competition.
So it wasn't policed as well as it could be because of that. I guess policed isn't really the right word for this because
no.
We want Twitch to be a healthy environment. And
isn't Twitch though, is it? I think it said it was on a different server.
Uh-oh.
So here's the thing that really got me is that like this the guy the.
Twitch live stream.
The person who was in charge of this was like, or who was participating, was like, I expected comments. I didn't expect them that bad. Like, that really sucks.
And he was saying, like, his family came and watched the stream, and then they had to see that in the chat, and that's just a shitty thing. You know, and so one of the moderators said that they were completely unprepared for the flood of racism, and that some of the moderators actually contributed to the problem because...
What?
If you've been on Twitch, you know an event like this is going to draw out racist, sexist, and hateful comments. I didn't think anyone anticipated it would be this bad, though.
Oh, more mods got recruited.
Yeah, so they were frantically communicating via Skype, and there just weren't enough mods. So this is a problem that actually is very persistent on Twitch.
I mean, it's the reason that, like... Again, when I started doing Twitch, my parents were like, oh, is that going to be okay? Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm kind of scared.
Yeah. So Twitch has, I don't know, they've always had these kinds of issues, and they've got an online guide now for...
What should we do? How to manage harassment in chat?
Your reaction, I'm curious. First thing is to choose how you're going to react. Hmm.
They want attention, so what are you supposed to do, ignore them?
I mean, it's hard because maybe as... I think this is a thing that Zach actually has had different opinions than some of us here about. Zach is the kind of person that will just call out a troll for being a troll. Other people maybe don't approach them because they have a fear of being doxxed or whatever. And so it's like a really weird, tricky situation where you kind of don't, you have to pay attention to like what kind of troll that person is being. And that just gives them more attention, which is difficult.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, we got to give a shout out to our mods who make this a safe place. But like part of it, like I've been afraid of starting my channel because I'm like, what's going to happen?
Yeah.
When I'm streaming, I can't control that. So this is going to be a good thing for me to read.
Yeah. Yeah, and David Guy says Twitch is really what you make it. If you don't control your chat, it has the potential to go crazy. And that's true. You know, we're very particular about the way that we have our community.
Yeah,
you know, like we want it to be a safe and inviting place for you guys. And if we're just letting, you know, rude people stream through here and say the rude things,
we're not going.
We're not creating an inclusive environment.
Just start mass banning. That's a band-aid. Yeah. Mass banning is just a band-aid.
Yeah,
okay,
it is.
So.
It is 216.
You
know why I know that?
Thank you guys so much for the chat, for being so hearty. I like that we're talking about Overwatch. I think, and Minker, I will think about your idea about possible mods. Thank you, Peanut Butter Bitch, for being polite. We are going to get our hosts in here.
Our guests. We're hosts.
We're going to get our guests in here. We're going to maybe move some of the wands to get ready for that talk. Who is coming again?
Green Ronin Publishing is here to talk about their Kickstarter for the Book of the Righteous for 5th edition. And we've got Nicole Lindrus and Chris Primus.
Joe, please play the video now.
Hi, I'm Aaron Loeb, author of Book of the Righteous. Book of the Righteous represents about a decade worth of work. It was created back when Chris Primus and I were in college and was the pantheon for our homebrew campaign. And it's been used in many, many campaigns over the years. And finally, we turned it into a big source book back for 3rd edition. And this Kickstarter represents the first opportunity for it to come into 5th edition. Book of the Righteous is a complete mythology with a whole host of gods and a fully written out church for every one of the gods in that pantheon. There's holy warriors, there's clerics, there's everything that you need to know to play one of those. There's mythologies or myths that are specific to each of the churches. There's a complete explanation of what you call the holy orders, how they're addressed, the relationships between the various churches. It goes on to have large campaign hooks and ideas for how to incorporate the religion into your campaign, including ideas of how to change the fundamental religion itself and how to make alterations. It talks a little bit about the kind of rules of the mythology, so you understand the sort of underlying system of where it came from, so if you want to change it or tinker with it, that's easy. There's a church that represents all of the gods. It's just, there's pretty much everything you could ever need to incorporate a fairly deeply thought out religion into your campaign. And for this new edition, which will be in hardcover and full color, the new 5th edition rules will be provided, and I'm incredibly excited about this, by Rob Schwab, who I got to work with on Book of Fiends and is, in my book, one of the greatest living authors of paper and pencil game design. I'm just a huge fan of his work. So it will be a lavishly illustrated, incredibly thorough book for bringing religion into your campaign. So we hope that you will join us and support the Book of the Righteous Kickstarter, and we thank you very much for your support.
We are here with our guests, Nicole Lindrus and Chris Primus from Green Ronin Publishing, to talk about their Kickstarter for the Book of the Righteous for 5th edition. So, if you guys want to talk a little bit about Green Ronin, I know you are a little bit sick, a little bit under the weather, so your voice is not...
I'm going to make hand gestures.
Yeah. That sounds great. That sounds great.
Well, hi. I'm Chris Primus. I'm the president of Green Ronin. Thanks for having us in.
Yeah.
We are primarily a role-playing game company, although we publish some card games as well, like Love to Hate, which is one of our previous Kickstarters. So we've been in the game publishing business since the year 2000, so it's our 16th year. And we have a Kickstarter going on for a new edition of our classic Book of the Righteous source book for 5th edition D&D. So this is the original book here. People can see this, hopefully.
Yes.
Yeah.
The pros.
Here, actually, we can
love to hold it. Yeah, it's there.
Ooh, magic. So the original book was published in 2002, back during the time of 3rd edition D&D. Basically, it is a gigantic divine source book. So what it does is it provides an entire cosmology and a whole family of gods that you can use in your campaign. And it has a lot of information for religious characters, clerics, paladins, or just devout characters of any sort. The idea is to update this to the new 5th edition rules. And to do that, we got a bunch of the designers from 5th edition D&D. So Robert J. Schwab is leading the development and design. And we also have Rodney Thompson. And they were both on the original 5e design team. And then just today we announced that Jeremy Crawford, who is one of the lead designers, is going to be writing a foreword for the new book. So that one more.
That's awesome. Yeah. Also, chat has noticed that you also were on an episode of Tabletop. You DM'd the Dragon Age game.
That is true. Ah. Yes. Yes. It was a two-part episode. I ran Dragon Age for Will Wheaton, Chris Hardwick, Sam Witwer, and that other guy. Whose name I always forget. From Big Bang Theory.
He's going to be so mad at
you. I know he's going to be mad at me.
Sorry, I'm sitting here being like, oh, I get the next one. So currently, Green Ronin has a Kickstarter going for your next project, The Book of the Righteous. We're looking at this, right? Yep. Can you tell us more about your Kickstarter and why maybe you went to Kickstarter?
One of the things I thought was cool about Kickstarter when it came around is there are certain projects that we would look at and be like, well, you know, we're not sure if people want that or don't want that. And, you know, it used to be you could find that out by losing a lot of money. So I think what's nice about Kickstarter is you can say to people like, hey, we want to make this cool thing. Do you want it? And then if they say yes and give you money, you're like, aces, let's make it. And then if they don't, then you've saved yourself a lot of grief and crying. So
we like to save the crying.
Yeah. I totally understand that.
Yeah. One of our previous Kickstarters was to do a book called Freeport, The City of Adventure. Freeport is a long-running fantasy setting that we did. Actually, one of our very first products was an adventure called Death in Freeport that kicked off that whole setting. But I want to do like a really super deluxe version of the city. So, you know, like a 544-page full-color hardback with a poster map. And, you know, that's the sort of thing you could sink $50,000 into, and then if no one cared, you'd be super sad. So, you know, that was like a perfect project for Kickstarter. And Book of the Righteous is sort of the same approach.
Cool. So I am curious, though, how the... because obviously there's a community that builds up around Kickstarters, mm-hmm. and each Kickstarter sort of has their own individual community. But have you had a difficult time or an easy time sort of retaining those communities and introducing them to the things that you're doing as you continue on?
So each of our Kickstarters has been a little different. We haven't been hitting like the same fan base with everyone. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Freeport was for the Pathfinder role-playing game. This is 5th edition. They have an overlapping fan bases, but it's not all the same. We did one for our Blue Rose role-playing game.
Yeah, I managed that one, and that's completely different. That's for the age system, and it also focuses...
It looks so good, too. I'm so excited.
The romantic fantasy isn't exactly the same.
It looks so good, you guys.
So, it's not really overlapping fan bases, except that we're behind...
Right.
We're behind the project.
Do you find that that's a challenge when you have to sort of switch gears?
It's been a challenge for our entire company career, I think, because we just have done things that have been interesting to us, where some companies are just very much Pathfinder or whatever.
Yeah,
I'm jealous. There's
Savage Worlds would be a good one. Savage Worlds is Savage Worlds, and they do there, and they've got their Savage Worlds fans.
Yeah.
And Green Ronin fans may or may not be interested in any individual thing that we're working on.
Right. But that's also kind of exciting because you get to try all these different things. Yep. And then if
that's
someone,
what we like to do.
Right, exactly. I mean, it's been 16 years of doing this. So I imagine that if you didn't like it, you would stop. But
it's sort of reflective of just me in that I like to.
I think.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Us. That's fair. You know, I like to play all sorts of different games. And so it's as a publisher, it's attractive to have a model like Paizo's, where it's like they have one game and they have one setting and that is it. Everything happens in Galarian and it's all Pathfinder.
Yeah.
So, you know, their fans are their fans. But yeah, we have a Game of Thrones role-playing game. We have a Dragon Age role-playing game. You know, we have Fantasy Age, Blue Rose. Yeah, so.
We've done the Ashes of Volcana, all the Titan's Grave stuff is completely, again, a whole other thing, ties into different groups.
So how many people are working on this particular project?
So it was originally written by Aaron Loeb, who's a freelancer. Aaron actually is a bigwig in video games. He works for Kabam, which is a huge mobile company. And
I think you mean he runs Kabam?
Yeah. Yeah, he's like president of Worldwide Studios or something fancy like that. Yeah. So he wrote, what is the meat of the book. And then Rob Schwab, who used to be on staff with us, but now he went to work for Wizards for a while, and now he's on his own. He's going to be doing the development and design work, and helping him with design is Rodney Thompson. So that's all going to be freelance stuff. What we'll do in-house is art direction, layout, and oversight and that sort of thing.
Cool. Sorry, I'm like thinking about what Chad's saying and trying to piece together, because there's a lot of names happening, and I know they're important names, but being very new to the industry, I'm just like, important people.
I did a podcast once where I got in trouble for name dropping, because I was just like, and then my friend this person, and then that person that I know, and then when we were gaming with Will Wheaton, and all of a sudden people were like,
relax.
Name drops. And I was like, oh, right.
Sorry. Well,
our chat loves it.
You guys do, don't lie. Yeah.
Well, but
when you've been around in the industry for 16 years, you know a lot of people, and it's such a tight-knit industry that those people just become your friends, and then that's who you know. Like, that's just your circle. That's
my 27th year of gaming before we started the company.
Right.
These are just people grew up in the industry with a bunch of these
people. Gen Con, going to Gen Con and meeting these people, and then everybody kind of comes up on their own, and then everyone...
Well, you've got a perspective on
that,
Emily.
I do have a perspective on that. I actually used to work for Green Runny for a little bit.
Emily.
Yeah, I was an intern. It was great.
I also like to name check people simply because traditionally, a lot of times in games, people wouldn't even understand who made their games.
Right.
And so, oftentimes you're doing work for very little recognition.
Yes.
So it's the least I can do.
Yes. A lot of the time it adds credibility to things. Not necessarily that you guys need the credibility, but in general, it helps add credibility. If you see the name from somebody that you know attached to a project that you may not have seen otherwise, that gives it reason to be interested.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I am curious what sort of strategies you guys have used in order to sort of spread the word, because you've done 6 of these, right?
Mm-hmm. And they've been doing well.
They've all done well.
Which is,
so,
I mean, Kickstarter's either hit it off or don't. Yeah. So I want to know your secrets.
Actually,
you can come visit me.
Yeah.
When we first started, it was still, first started the company, that is, it was still the era where you might do something like buy a print ad in a magazine like Dragon or something like that. And that era is just over.
Yes. Yeah.
There's like nowhere we're going to print advertise our Kickstarter.
Yeah.
So it's all basically online. It's, it's social media. It's, going out to podcasts. It's giving interviews for websites. There is that part of Kickstarter, which is just like, for the month that your Kickstarter is going on, you just got to bang the drum every day, no matter how annoying it seems to you that you're talking about it all the time. Inevitably, 2 days after the Kickstarter ends, someone will go, what? There was a Book of the Righteous Kickstarter? Yes, I didn't hear about that.
And they'll still be upset.
Yeah.
I look at my G+ feed and I'm like, geez, it's like,
well, that's why
Book of the Righteous all the way down.
Second chance backing exists at this point because it's kind of silly that it needs to because.
Wait, what is that?
Second chance backing. So it's this thing where you do your Kickstarter and then a lot of the time people will hear about it after it's done because it'll be like this big press push where, this finished funding.
Look how it finished.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, now it's
and then
all
you're
done.
Like, oh God, I want that. Mm-hmm. So then you have an opportunity for a second chance backing, and you usually have to do that outside of Kickstarter. You have to do it in a different format.
Oh, yeah.
And so it's a second wave, basically. And how do you feel about second chance backing, actually?
I am all for people giving me money for the things that I make, however they want to do that.
Yeah. I feel that
pretty
way
much.
Yeah. Will this book then be in stores?
Yes.
Okay.
That's the other thing for us is that we maintain our regular business of selling books into game stores and through game distribution.
Right.
So of all the Kickstarters we've done, the only one that didn't go into stores was the 10th anniversary edition of Mutants and Masterminds, because that was meant to be a special like Kickstarter exclusive. But generally speaking, when we do a project, it's going to go into stores after. So if you do somehow manage to miss everything, you know, like Blue Rose will be out in August. You'll be able to
buy
it. Oh, right.
So for things like Blue Rose, do you feel like you wouldn't have been able to create them outside of Kickstarter?
Blue Rose was always a really weird project for us because we were specifically shooting for an offshoot of fantasy role playing.
I actually feel like a lot of people in chat would really enjoy this project, so definitely look at it.
So it was that way when we did it the first time around, 10 years ago, now, I've lost the train of thought because I'm on cold medicine.
That's
like,
okay.
I have
me
a
too.
Hamster brain today.
Me too.
So, yes.
Yes.
So I think we could have done Blue Rose just as one of our regular products that we just announce and sell through normal channels. But one of the reasons we want to take it to Kickstarter, honestly, was for the marketing angle of it, because a Kickstarter campaign is also like a month-long marketing campaign. And, in the 10 years since we originally published Blue Rose, you know, when we did that romantic fantasy game and it was very, you know, it was diverse fantasy, it was very queer-friendly, you know, like a lot of gamers were like, what? You know?
What? And think about 10 years ago, like that thing, that kind of thing just, it wasn't as prevalent as it is now.
No.
We got a lot of pushback. We got pre-Gamergate pushback on that project.
Yeah.
It was
great.
That's awesome. The best.
So with all the general social progress that had been made with, you know, gay marriage and trans issues and all this stuff, we figured, you know, that this would be a great time to bring Blue Rose back and, you know, make sure that gamers understood that, you know, that there's people in the game industry who really believe that gaming is for everyone, and, you know, here's a game where you can be represented, and it's still a kick-ass
game. And I think Kickstarter was the way to reach that community.
Yeah.
Because, again, it's Green Ronin. We don't... Fans of the Black Company or gritty Warhammer fans are maybe not the same audience for this game.
Yeah, that's definitely true. See what chat has to say about Blue Rose.
There's a couple of people saying they're going to check it out and that it's available in August. Mm-hmm. So that's where a lot of them can jump on it. A lot of them actually have been talking about online resources. And I noticed in your Kickstarter, you do have offered PDFs.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is that something that's do you feel like is necessary or
Oh, yeah. We sell all of our stuff in PDF form and book form. And then we have this program called Pre-Order Plus. So when for non-Kickstarter stuff, when we finish a book and the PDF is complete and we're going to send it to print, we'll then put it up for pre-order at that point. And you can just buy the PDF right away, or you can pre-order the print book. And if you do that, you can get the PDF as a $5 add-on instead of its regular price.
Some companies look at their PDFs as free add-on content, and we don't. We have a kind of complex relationship with that stuff, but so we don't bundle, and we try to be really retailer friendly, brick and mortar store friendly, and that's a hard thing for them. Either you give it away for free to everybody, if I have a sale where I'm going to give somebody a $5 PDF for pre-ordering, I want to make that offer to the retail store too.
Right.
So that's what we do.
Well, and that's great that you guys are supportive of the local game stores because,
that's something that needs to happen.
Exactly.
Yeah, so they can get in, retail stores can get in on the Pre-Order Plus program, and then what we do is we provide them codes. So if someone pre-orders that book through their store, they give them a code that can be redeemed on our website for the $5 PDF. So the retailers don't feel undercut.
Yep, that's right.
Yeah. Do you feel like your Kickstarter community has any sort of effect on the content that you put into the game? Or do you have plans sort of in, not in stone, but basically there before they come to it?
I think usually we know what we want the project to be, and we're floating it for the people who want it.
Right.
So occasionally it's been like, could you add this? Or we want a GM screen, or is there a thing that you could put into this? We're like, that's a great idea. Now we've got a new level.
Nice. Goals.
Right?
Yeah.
There's definitely stuff that people, you know, that we maybe hadn't fully considered before we started getting people requesting it, like, you know, support for Hero Lab or Fantasy Grounds, which are, so we have a Fantasy Grounds option if you use that to do online gaming. for Book of the Righteous and for previous Kickstarters. We've done Hero Lab support, and it's a stretch goal for this one.
Well, yeah, let's actually take a look at the Kickstarter page. So you guys are almost at your goal.
Almost there.
Seven days. It's completely doable. And if you guys are interested, definitely go check it out. It's going to be a really interesting book. So let's take a look at some of the levels. So you can back a dollar, and you just get thank yous.
Thanks.
I like those levels. Thank you. But actually, I am curious because this is something that we've seen at Harebrained Schemes. Mm. When people back for a dollar, they're mostly doing it so that they can be in the comments.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have that happen a lot? Because I think a lot of the people who back for a dollar will probably buy it eventually.
I personally will back a campaign for a dollar so that I don't forget about it. Mm-hmm. I know I want to back it.
Yeah.
I don't have the bandwidth right at the moment to look at it, but I want to get the updates sent to me as a reminder. Hey, this thing was matched. Hey, we want this. Hey, now everybody who orders gets a free tchotchke, whatever it is.
Yeah.
So that's my strategy. Yeah. I'm not one of those like I'm paying to get in and argue in the comments or anything. Don't do that. But I think that there are people who do that. I don't think we see too much of that in ours, actually.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Also, I mean, if you back even for a dollar, that means you'll have access to the backer kit, right? Which means you can get in on things later.
True.
Which is pretty nice. and then there are even ways to get the old edition, which I saw, which is kind of nice because some people are still...
Oh yeah,
hard in that old 3 or 3.5.
Yeah, it was a 3.0 book. So one of the major features of the original book was there was a new class in it called the Holy Warrior, which was basically like a class that lets you make a paladin for any alignment, more or less. Mm.
It was popular.
Yes, it was very popular. So we updated that to the 3.5 rules, and that will be included. Bundled in with the old book. So if you still play D&D 3.5, you know, we got you covered there.
They got you.
Can you tell us a little bit about the art, too? Because it is gorgeous.
Hal Mangold is our partner in the company, and he also does our art direction and graphic design. The original book was done in black and white, and one of the big features of this one is that we're going to go full color.
Is that a goal, or is that just how we're going to do it?
You're just doing it.
Part of that $25,000.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So. Yeah. If you want color.
Well, basically, I mean, when books get above a certain size and you know, you really want to sell them as premium things, you know, you really kind of have to go color these days. Mm-hmm. And particularly, like, all the D&D 5th edition books are color, and, you know, we want to follow on with that as well. We haven't really mentioned it so far, but we actually worked with Wizards of the Coast to make two official 5th edition D&D books with
them. As the design house for them that they published.
So we did a big mega adventure with them called Out of the Abyss, where you go into the Underdark and all these demon lords are involved. And then we did a book called The Sword Coast Adventurer's Guide, which is really the only sort of like player-oriented book that they've done for 5th edition so far. So it's got some new character options, a bunch of info about the Forgotten Realms and so on. So we worked, you know, hand in glove with Wizards to make those two books. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like we have some good experience with 5th edition.
Nice. So you've got a lot of like actually lower priced tiers where you still get PDFs.
Just pretty
That's
nice.
That's awesome.
Yep. Yeah, we try when designing these things to give people a bunch of choices, you know, from PDFs, you know, to bundles. There's Fantasy Ground options, and then there are some higher level tiers where you can get yourself or a character of yours illustrated.
Oh, let's take a look.
That's the one that I was looking at.
Those are the $150 ones.
There we go. You have three left on that one. You can be a holy warrior.
Yeah.
Or an unholy warrior. Notice how that one is much less. There's only one left of that one, which that's always super fun. And do you know who's the artist who will be doing those? Or
no, we haven't recruited the art team yet. So it'll be several different artists.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. But we work with good people. So
we do.
Of course. I mean, if we had time to flip this book, I bet we'd just be amazed by it. And I know a lot of people have been talking about other of your books in the chat.
Well, and if I may be so bold, we've upped our game since 2002. So.
Oh.
Yeah. Do you hear that? That sounds like a challenge. I think you should compare and contrast.
Upped your game. Because you guys have been doing Kickstarters for a long time, and you guys have had more successful Kickstarters than I would say a lot of people have. So
you've been growing on that, and you've even said that you haven't had your base to build off, which is very incredible to me.
Yeah, you know, we're still like waiting for that one that goes just bananas, you know. And it's that's just alchemy. I mean, you know, it's like right project, right time. You know, it's just you can't really predict it. But
I got it.
Yeah.
Cthulhu.
Uh huh.
Patrick Rothfuss.
Right.
Prophet.
There you go. Just put two things together, makes it work.
Patrick Rothfuss in a Cthulhu mask makes potato salad.
I feel like we just need a couple potato salad. Yeah.
No, it's out there.
Just need to roll some dice to like.
No, I feel like it's those magnets. Those like those fridge magnets.
Yeah. Yeah, you just stick them together.
Like, ah.
I've got it.
Done it. There was a couple more. Did we get all the questions?
Go back to that.
Yeah, you lost it. I just want to talk about, because I know a lot of people have been thinking about Kickstarters. Mm-hmm. And for me personally, what would you advise for our authors or audience if you wanted to give book development advice or Kickstarter development advice?
I think the advice I would give at this point is that you really want to have a lot of stuff to show, and you want to spend some time pre-marketing.
Mm-hmm.
So when we first started, we liked to do the sort of surprise Kickstarter, like, surprise, the Advanced Bestiary is coming back, you know, and then people get very excited because they didn't know about it and da-da-da. But it seems like you get a better response now if you spend a month or more, you know, letting people know.
In 6 months, I'm going to have a Kickstarter.
Exactly.
And now there's the ticker for the Kickstarter event. For the Kickstarter for the book that's coming next year.
Exactly. Yeah. Do you think that there's Kickstarter burnout, though?
Oh, yes. Well,
I feel like it's really starting to kick in there.
It has become very, very crowded.
Kickstarter burnout. Like, people are, if you are constantly doing projects, unless you've got a reputation for delivering those things, a lot of the time people don't know whether
you've backed like I backed 3 Kickstarters last week myself personally.
Yeah.
I'm like I'm out for the rest of the month.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah, people are on a budget, you know, and so you know when something comes along,
you have things ready to show off.
Right, definitely.
But even then, you know, the Kickstarter market area,
it's just very dense.
It's crowded.
Yeah.
It's right now as we launched ours, there are multiple high dollar successful Kickstarters going on, which is great for the community, but also a whole like second tier of people who can't get any traction and once you've backed like I backed 3 Kickstarters last week myself personally.
Yeah.
I'm like I'm out for the rest of the month.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah, people are on a budget, you know, and so you know when something comes along that is going to make like $3 million, it sucks a lot of air out of the room.
Yeah, it does.
But also, I mean, there are people who just have given up on Kickstarter entirely because they got burned one time and they're like, never again. And you're like, look,
that's
I mean,
a defeatist attitude.
Right, like,
one time is a little hard.
Yes, I read a bad book. I'm never going to a bookstore again.
Right.
You know, like, it's kind of strange.
It's so hard when, like, let's say you throw like a $500 towards a board game that never exists.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I think reputation is a huge part of that, and you guys have built that reputation.
No, the one that stabbed me in the heart, there's an old Avalon Hill game called Upfront, which I loved, and there was finally going to be a new edition of it, and I backed it for like $125, super excited about it, and you know, it was one of those things where the whole thing fell apart, and the guy moved to Australia, and the, you know, it was just like, and I don't even care about the money. It's that, like, that game. Right, I want that game.
I want the thing.
Now I can't have it.
Yeah. No, I'm finally getting a couple of my Kickstarters from years ago.
Nice.
Pigeons.
Nice. So it's about time for us to wrap up and get ready for WTF is This, but please tell them a little bit about yourselves and the Kickstarter really quick, one last time.
One sentence to review.
That's really
This
limited.
Is the divine source book for 5th edition D&D that you really want to have, and it even if you don't want a complete cosmology, let's say you have one already, you can get a lot of info here on how do you portray a cleric of a god of war or a god of the hearth or whatever. So if you're interested in having religion in your game at all, check it out.
All right.
This is Nicole Lindrus. You can find her on Twitter at Nick Chick, and Chris Pramus. You can find him at Pramus, correct?
Yep.
And Green Ronin Publishing, which is at Green Ronin Pub.
Right on.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, we have, thank you so
thank
much
you.
For
thank
being with
guys.
Us. And next up is WTF Is This with Kirby
and then Trivia
Hop.
Yes. So let's
shut it down, Joe.
Shut it down.
Shut it down, Joe.
Bye, Internet.